My name is Lantigotian.
Lantigotian? Is that...
No, it's. I think it's land to Goshen. What is that, the expression? Land to Goshen. Are you the new Edwin Newman, or am I the new Edwin Newman?
I'm part of the grammar police, Edwin Newman.
Edwin Newman was my go-to grammar reference.
Mm-hmm.
I hate to say you were wrong, but that Mitch McConnell seems like a pretty nice guy. You were really, you know, Paul Ryan, you said they wouldn't stand up for what's right. But I guess you were wrong, David. It's time for you to reconsider. Those guys went to the mat. They're going to go to the mat for what's right. Family values.
I think their hearts are in the right place and they love this
yes.
country. And we don't need, at this point, an investigation into the Comey firing. And from what I understand, McConnell is standing with our president, right?
Hey, both sides do it. Both sides do it. Both sides.
Uh-huh.
Both sides are responsible. Both sides are responsible for Mike Flynn. Both sides.
Hey, Donald somehow. Trump isn't tweeting from a private server like you know who.
Oh, thank God. That's the only thing that I've been happy about, was that he didn't, you know, all this time I said the only thing that'd be worse than this is if he missed a small, tiny C in one of his emails. If they tried to bury the classified information in an email to fool the person receiving it, he might not catch that. Thank God. Oh, my God. All the stuff that she was doing, she was making $1 billion a second on the Clinton Foundation. Unbelievable.
Well, they're horrible people, the Clintons. She enabled him.
Also, she's crooked.
She's crooked?
Did you hear about it?
Yeah.
Did you hear about that?
Yeah.
Who needs it?
I don't need it.
Mitch McConnell, his eyes are so beady. One is the second part of this joke. His eyes are so beady.
Yeah.
I know there's something good.
They're so beady.
They're so close together, they often switch. No, not good.
He's not cross-eyed, he's Star of David-eyed.
You know why scientists have decided why people like him have, like, beady eyes? They found out why.
Why?
Because he's a racist.
I don't want to say he has beady eyes, but on Mardi Gras, I throw them at the floats. That's how beady.
I don't want to say his eyes are beady, but they're available as curtains.
I don't want to say his eyes are beady, but they directed Reds.
Hey, you know, David Feldman, you never told me that there was a woman in the studio when I was talking fake dirty last time. There was a lady in the studio.
A lady?
Who's a comic.
A comic and lady?
She's a comic lady. So I direct messaged her. I followed her on Twitter. I direct messaged her and I say, I just want to let you know, I hope you weren't offended. I would never talk like that if I knew you was a woman there. Never heard back from her, David. Thank you. Thank you, David.
You know why?
Why?
Because you didn't take your hat off when you sent that email to that nice lady. How many times do I have to tell you when you were corresponding with a lady comic, you're supposed to remove your hat?
Oh, I didn't know that. Pardon me, ma'am. I had no idea.
Well, if you had read Edwin Newman, you would
exactly.
know. You would. Boy, exactly. He would. Edwin Newman. Go ahead.
No. I had nothing. Go ahead.
Edwin Newman and Bill Sapphire, these grammarians, the PC police, they're policing language, and it's wrong.
I ain't going to look up ain't in the dictionary because I know it ain't there. Now, what was wrong with our society that became a saying?
Ain't?
No, people would actually go, I ain't going to look up ain't in a dictionary because I know it ain't there. I heard that. That means more than four or five people passed that around as a hilarious limerick.
If you look up ain't in the dictionary.
It ain't there?
You see.
A picture of me? You see a picture of me with a pail of paint? Hey, if you look up inarticulate in a dictionary, you'll see like a, they'll have like a, they'll have like a photo. If you look up inarticulate in a dictionary, they'll have like a, it'll be like a thing about, and it will somehow wind up with me.
Do you know that I looked up dictionary?
And what happened? In the dictionary?
Yeah, it said a compendium of words with definitions. Is that funny? I just don't. That never
works. I
think works.
It's fantastic. But you don't go by me. I haven't had a joke that's worked since the 40s.
Did you?
My last joke that worked, I had a fantastic chunk. It was Y2K, why not? I said, Y2K, why not 2K? That's just how I opened it. And then I said, let me get this straight. Let me get this straight. At 1999, at 11:59 and 59 seconds, what? Is my clock going to turn into a kangaroo? What's going to happen, Y2K people? And then what happened with Y2K? You know what happened, right? Nothing.
It was like the comet Kohoutek? Did I get that
It was
right?
like the comet Kohoutek.
Remember the comet Kohoutek?
Oh, no, I don't remember that. Is that like Geraldo's vault?
Yes. Geraldo's vault. Oy, the vault. There was nothing in
there. The vault with Geraldo.
There was nothing in there.
Did you see when they did the remake of that? Geraldo looking in Al Capone's vault, starring Rachel Maddow and the taxes?
Yes.
She knew. Here's what's unforgivable. She knew she had nothing before the show. She could have said, oh, things got lost or wasn't a big deal, but she kept going, we have them here and we'll be talking about them. Watch this space.
She had David K. Johnson on with her to go over the
taxes.
True. It was 20 minutes of her saying, welcome, David K. Johnson. And he said, you don't have to call me David K. Johnson. You can call me David Johnson.
That was 1 minute?
That was 1 minute. Then you can call me DK Johnson. You can call me...
You can call me Ray. And then he said at one point, let's get this out of the way at the beginning, Rachel. He probably sent it to me. Let's get that on the record.
Yep.
Which he did say that he sent it to him.
For those of you who aren't able to follow this, join the club. No, it's David K. Johnson, the author of...
Him I like though.
I love David K. Johnson. He wrote it.
But it's Rachel. I blame it all on Rachel because Rachel, you know what it is? Rachel didn't have to play the clubs. She didn't have to struggle in the clubs like Ricky Gervais did. You know what I mean? Ricky Gervais, he would put on a disguise so that you wouldn't know it was Ricky Gervais coming to the club. Do you know that he put announcements on his Twitter? It's new joke night for me. I'm working on my new jokes. Thinking about doing this joke tonight, but it's so offensive, even I'm offended by it. That guy is the worst, right? I've gone past it being a friendly feud now. He's worse than Hitler. He's like if Hitler wasn't funny, and then his material was written by Stalin.
But The Office was so good.
It was so great. He's like Stalin, but he likes animals.
But the shaky camera and then, you know, the cutaways.
That was a great show. That was the best show. I watched that show. I made everybody watch it. Everybody. I said, this is the greatest show ever. So that's why this guy has the nerve. All I'm doing is pointing out that he stinks now. And now I'm the bad guy. I know you like Derek, David. You call me up every week. You go, did you try Derek again? Did you try it? And I said, David, I don't want to watch a show that's about, like, where they're talking about they're kind of soft-selling that he's has mental problems. No, no. He says he doesn't have any mental problems in the show.
He captured, you know, the really annoying boss that we all have.
That was the greatest show of all time. I even liked Extras, David Feldman.
That show was... I never saw it, but I'll defend it. And he speaks... Power to Truth at the Golden Globes. I mean, he got up.
Oh, he does. He does. Those are such edgy jokes. First of all, I can't even believe that someone would have the ball to do a Mel Gibson joke. I mean, really. And it's so current, too, with the Mel Gibson jokes.
That's dangerous.
Mel Gibson still hates the Jews. Hey, you know, it's 2017, but Mel Gibson is still writing I Hate the Jews on his checks.
I want to know if he hates the Jews so much, how come his name is Mel?
That is a very good point. Maybe that's why he hates the Jews so much. But he's a guy who doesn't... Now, here's the thing. Whoopi Goldberg is friends with him. Is this a guy who just, like, when he gets drunk, then the anti-Semitism comes out?
Wait, Whoopi is friendly with him. It's, you know what it is? It's Gentiles with Jewish names. That's how you know who the real anti-Semites are.
Oh, so when he said to Whoopi, you're one of the good ones, She took it the wrong way. She thought it was black. They said, no, one of the Jews doesn't look like a Jew. Whoopi Goldberg, I really was wrong about saying that she wasn't funny, because she has really brought so much to the table. She's redefined comedy as tragedy.
Now, you carry a check in your wallet.
Yes, and this check is made out for $1 million. It's made out to Whoopi Goldberg. And all it says in the memo part was, she was funny. She was funny. And you get the check. Just, was your favorite Whoopi Goldberg movie Eddie? Do you know there was a movie called Eddie?
No.
Okay. The very first Day of the Industry is available for digital download. And you know they say there's not a lot of money in this digital world? It costs 99 cents to download it. And after the first 4 million downloads, I get a penny. And they say this is a rough business? When they used to say you make a beautiful dollar in this business, did they really mean it was just one? David, you are my target audience. There's no reason to have even a career if I'm not talking to you.
Now, I understand. Is it a secret? Can I talk about the game that you're getting into? The racket?
Why is it that you sound like Bud Abbott leading me into a Who's on First material? Hello? No, you can talk about anything. Well, was there something secret? What happened?
Now, did you know Bud Abbott was Jewish?
I think I did know that. But Lou Costello wasn't, right?
Lou Costello was Italian.
I learned what? That from Shelley Berman in Vegas. I met Shelley Berman. He goes, it's not Iran. It is not Iraq. It's Iran. Iraq. Do you order Italian dressing? And he certainly put me straight.
I said to him, didn't know that. Yes. Yeah.
And you said, I'm sorry, I have Bob Newhart on the other line. And his head exploded.
Because the phone rang. That's the only reason he got exploded. Nobody gets that. Nobody's going to get
it. I love that so much. You know what, Ken? I love that. And I love the fact, I love these old style feuds. These were the greatest feuds of all time, where people would argue over.
Did he have a feud with Bob Newhart?
Oh, he refused to. Well, I just think he refused to talk. He just assumed that Bob Newhart took a deal from him.
Oh, you're breaking up. I don't know why.
Oh, it's not me breaking up. It's me, Novocaine, acting funny.
The Novocaine?
Yeah, I had Novocaine. Did I tell you I went to the dentist today? Some teeth work done. My mouth feels good, but you know what the problem is?
What?
I still can't feel my career.
Novocaine, by the way, is what you used to call Michael Caine after Alfie, right? You
said That's true. And then you used to say, I've eaten so much of these locks now that I'm numb from them. It's like I'm from Novocaine.
Nova Scotia, you're saying.
Nova Scotia Caine. Remember those jokes? And they worked because there wasn't a television back then.
And there wasn't an audience who would have to tell you the joke wasn't funny.
Right. Back then when we started, you only changed your act seasonally. You never changed the material. If it was spring, you added some spring material in there. But you never changed your material. We both played like 2,000 to 3,000 vaudeville houses.
Right.
And so no one saw us. They see us once every 4 years.
And then Comedy on the Road went on NBC in 1933.
And the rest, right?
We blew our act. That was
We really did. You kept saying, don't let it be filmed. Don't let it be filmed. I said, what are you talking about? Then we can't do it live.
Right. They're not going to come see us.
But then nobody was booking us live. Is the problem. These bits go on forever, and I notice that I'm not, don't seem to be upping the level of the bit. So you take it to the, you add some humor to it. I just keep beating the same comedic premise.
Shelley Berman
yeah.
was the best-selling comedian in the early 60s.
Yeah, he had the album, right?
And he had the phone call routine. He was the first guy to get on the fake phone. And you're saying that Bob Newhart then got on the fake phone.
Well, Bob Newhart says that he didn't get it from Shelley Berman.
He got it from Ellen DeGeneres from The Time Machine.
I hear Ellen DeGeneres, she watches a lot of Lucy. You know that, Dave?
No.
She watches a lot of Lucy. But unfortunately, She watches Here's Lucy. You're the only person who has ever gotten that joke.
Viv. We both said Viv at the same time. Viv.
It's Robert Wagner. Viv. Unfortunately, she watched Here's Lucy. I love her show now, though. I know you're addicted to her daytime show because, you know, let's have some fun for a change.
I like her because she dances, and during the writer's strike, she supported her
what
viewers.
What did you do during the writer's strike?
She supported her viewers. You know, she kept the show going and
viewers.
During the strike, nobody was thinking about the viewers. That's the thing.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, people make fun of her now. Mm-hmm. But back then, she was thinking about the viewers.
Mm-hmm. And so she continued to do the show, and I thank her for that.
We are the most agreeable. You just started the most agreeable duo of all time. Mm-hmm. You sure are right, Andy. Mm-hmm. Ethel. William Holden. Ethel. It's William Holden.
I got an orange from his backyard.
They did that for 5 years where they would pretend that they were coming out to Hollywood and meet a celebrity.
But they already were in Hollywood.
I know, that's what fools me. I still can't get over the fact that Seinfeld was shot in New York. I mean, in L.A. If you look up short-term memory in the dictionary, what was I saying? Volare. I think Volare after every punchline now. Hey, are you a big Columbo fan like me, David Feldman?
One final question, Mr. Kindler.
Can you do Columbo? That was an all-purpose joke when I was a kid. When someone would do it, they go, how about doing the thing you said you were going to do? Boom.
Yes, I loved Columbo. I did love Columbo.
And yeah, I love it. I love it. And there was one thing where there's like he's on the ship, I think with Jack Cassidy. Mm-hmm. Jack Cassidy's in a few episodes, and this was woman singer is singing, Volare. Ba 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 boom. Oh, by the way, I've been pitching some shows to Antenna TV. I just pitched something to them, and they rejected. They said the picture's too clear. No one's going to buy it. I pitched a show to the Antenna TV. It's called Use a Coat Hanger and Lean It Against the Window.
Do you watch Antenna TV?
I do watch all the ones that show the old shows that make me forget that we're all doomed. I like Albert Hitchcock. Is it Alfred Hitchcock or Albert Hitchcock?
It's Albert Serling.
Oh, yeah. That makes sense. I love his hour show, the black and white show.
Yes, I do too.
I watch any Columbo. But then the old stuff, I don't know. You know, I was going to call you. I don't know why you've been telling me that My Mother the Car is the greatest show that was ever on TV. I don't think it holds up. I'll give it another shot. Do you know how badly Laugh-In holds up? The TV slides down the wall when I watch it. How about a little wall netto?
Laugh-In doesn't hold up, you say?
No.
I'm doing Dan Rowan, by the way.
It doesn't. You say.
Yeah.
You know who holds up, though? George Slaughter in a bar at 3 in the morning. You know how many years he said to me in Montreal, Andy Kindler, what should we do with you? Andy Kindler. I love what you do. You don't love what I do enough to stop saying my name and do something. Andy Kindler. Do you know why I had a network guy once tell me? His name was Scott Schneider. He worked at Comedy Central. He told me, look, Andy, I love what you do, but I don't, you know how the suits are. I said, you're one of the suits. He goes, I like it, but you know me. I'll run it by myself one more time. But it's just so good. I can't get it by me. I'll run it by myself one more time. Maybe I'll take myself out to a nice dinner. Spring it on myself.
my God.
So did you hear about, I have a show that I'd like you to be in, I'm pitching.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's and I know it's going to sell. It's called Aging Jews. And it's all about when life gives you lemons, commit suicide. It's that whole feels where everyone's depressed. But it's very slow. It's very slow going. Very slow going. And then every episode, things get worse, and their outlook becomes more cloudy.
Didn't you used to hang out at Jerry's in the Valley and frag Army's Army?
Well, I have sat. This is how sad my life is. I've sat at the Seinfeld table at the Jerry's on Coldwater Canyon, and I said to myself, pretty sweet. I'm at the Seinfeld table. It's depressing, isn't it? I mean, you know what? Why do I look at it that way? He's got a career. I have a career. We're both doing well, right?
Mm-hmm. There's room for everybody.
There's room for everybody. There's room for everybody as long as one person makes $12 trillion. And I'm and I just download my new residuals tracker app. I actually have a residuals tracker app.
Do you know that I got some residuals right before the strike authorization? I got a thick green envelope from the Writers Guild. And I thought, oh, ooh. Yeah. I swear to God, they were all for 2 cents. There were like 50 checks for 2 cents.
Oh.
Yeah.
Now, I wanted to start, I'm sure someone started this charity, but I wanted to start a charity where like every check is under like a couple dollars you could send into this place. And then they would cash. But I'm telling you, the overhead's going to be huge because I'm not flying coach anywhere, Dave. Can you imagine a guy starts this charity like pennies, every penny counts. And it's all about him using these, and then, but he insists on flying himself. You know, you see that pie chart, 50% operating expenses. Andy, you have the highest rating on Charity Navigator. I mean, the highest cost. So there's a.
Bud Abbott, it turns out.
You get what you pay for. Yeah.
Bud Abbott
was Jewish.
Bud Abbott was Jewish, and he was investigated by the FBI, and he had a very large porno collection. Did you know that?
Really? You'd say it was large?
Well,
did he have every ass Wednesday that I have? That's the best I could do. Oh, you said he had a large. Does he have, I can't think of one on Golden Blonde. Did he have that one?
Wait, I'm going in a different direction. Bud Abbott was investigated by the House Un-American Activities Committee, and they asked him to name names. and they said, you know, there's a lot of weird names of these communists, Mr. Abbott.
I don't know on third base?
Who was a Chinese communist?
I don't care what the name of the fellow was. Is he a communist or was he not a communist?
No, was the head of the Chinese Politburo.
Don't. You know, it's a funnier bit when the actual information is boring. Do you know my joke about the blacklist? I say I'm the last actor who is still a victim of the blacklist. Not only was I a communist, I never quit. I loved it. With Stalin, I was like making excuses. Like, look how roomy it is over there now since Stalin's taken over.
It's with the Ukraine. No more Kulyaks. Am I right about the Kulyaks? What?
Well, you can eat off the floor. I'll tell you, I don't normally like a rigged system, but they make it work over there. So I said that I was also willing to name names. I was going to say, Gallagher's a communist. I was just going to name comics I didn't like their act. I was accused of being a communist. Carrot Top. Huh? You were talking about Red?
What would you have done? Because Elia Kazan's granddaughter is getting trolled because her father...
Well, she shouldn't get trolled. Why is she getting... Well, is she saying weird things?
Well, she's defending her grandfather. Not for the communism, for raping Marilyn Monroe.
Oh, well, that's different.
Yeah.
Apparently, did he rape Marilyn Monroe?
I think he did.
This is a horrible field that we've attached ourselves to, where you can't quite remember. Let me think. I do believe he did. Did he rape Marilyn Monroe, or did he was he found in a fountain on the street fountain with 10 dead people in his trunk? Which one? Which one was him?
Was it you who said if you're moving to Los Angeles, you said always book Pete Fountain?
Oh, no, no. It was that's Bob Saget told me that his manager, good advice that his first manager gave him was always take Fountain.
Right, but I was going for a Pete Fountain joke.
Who's Pete Fountain?
Pete Fountain, wasn't he like a musician?
And we'll be back with elderly Jews who either have dementia or does it really matter if they don't after these messages. So, David, you started in Philadelphia. No, I told you. This is our version of the Sunshine Boys. No. Etta. I just want to say one thing. Your stall tactic of talking slower till the material comes to you, I see right through it. Who? What? How cold was it? Now, you know what? Here's my new bit, my favorite bit to do. You know what, David? I tried to give Fallon a chance. I just don't think he's funny. I don't know why you keep sending me these emails to watch him tonight, because he's going to do a great voice. The other thing I love to do is go to cities like Portland and berate them for Trump. That's what I like. Nice going, Portland. Great. Nice job.
Don't you think people are overreacting to him?
You know what? I was ready. You know me. I was ready not to like him. But I have to admit, not as bad as I thought we would be all dead and radiated by now. Not too bad. Not too bad.
You love this country.
I thought my mother would be growing a third eye by this time. So you know what? It's not bad. Plus, you know what? He keeps them guessing. They've tried it for years with, oh, the president, he knows things. And where did it get us? Trump. I think he's the worst. Not only do I hate his guts, I hate his face. I hate watching him. I can't believe one person would vote for that. He's like everybody you hated. How many bullies in high school were voting in this last election?
I love this country, and you do. I wish him well. I mean, if he succeeds...
I love that. That's my favorite voice that you do. Now, don't you? This is outrageous, Andy.
You got to wish him well. I mean, he's our president. If he succeeds, we all succeed. We're all in
this
together.
You know what? If he comes to me with an infrastructure bill, I'm not going to turn it down.
How could you say no to that?
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, it's time for me maybe to look at some of the things I've done in the past, like been nice and cared about people.
I remember you complimenting female comedians without permission.
Yeah.
You would just walk up to them and say, great set.
I would say, and this, I'm not proud of this, but I have to say, and I used to couch it as a comedian thing. I said, I need to feel the temperature of your pussy before. It was different. It wasn't grabbing them. It was insert. I used to insert things up women's private parts for a comedic reason.
You know, you did inside jokes and you would just.
Right. Go. Inside. That's right. I need to feel how moist it was in the woman comics. Oh, I'm the bad guy? Oh, I'm the bad guy. Because I say to the crowd, are you ready for a vag comedian? Oh, I'm wrong. I'm wrong. Hey, you're lucky it's not the day of the month that she's ovulating, people. You remember my material. It was edgy, but it had an edge.
Do you watch Saturday Night Live? You must really love the way they're taking on Donald Trump.
Well, I hate Lorne Michaels. I'll hate him forever. I think he's the fish stinks from the top down, and any other analogy. So I can't stand him. I think he's like the biggest Wizard of Oz fake. Oh, what kind of popcorn was Lorne eating when he rejected that sketch?
Wait, hang on. He's in the room with me.
Let me finish. The type of sketch comedy that man brought to America is exactly what we needed. Call me someone who changes his mind. Call me mind changeable. But I see a different view that you said that, that he's there in the room with you. I feel differently. Let me finish. No, I actually think the women on the show are so goddamn funny. And the men on the show. I think they've done some good stuff. I loved Kate McKinnon doing Mika. Because I hate Morning Joe.
You called me. I remember you called me at 4 in the morning.
Right.
I live in New York. You live in L.A. And you were weeping the week after Hillary lost and Kate McKinnon sang Leonard Cohen's Hallelujah to start the show.
I actually did cry at that.
Did you really?
Yeah.
Are you putting me on? Is this a bit?
No, I like Kate McKinnon. I love her, and I was probably crying just because she was singing a song.
You know what the great thing about being Leonard Cohen is?
He's dead?
And he no longer has to hear the song Hallelujah when somebody dies.
I love him. I never knew that much about him. Now I start to see things. Where was I? Maybe I was a child. He once took acid and went on stage. He tells a story about that.
He was pretty amazing.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. He was a Montreal Jew. You know what they call Jews from Montreal?
What's that?
Jews.
Oh, interesting. Are you just working? Because you told me you might call me in the next couple of days just to work on the rhythm of your joke, that you didn't necessarily have material. But you want to run, just like running the same old lines you've been doing that your grandfather did. His joke's from my grandfather. You ready? A Jewish fella, he jumps into the water, and he's drowning, and he can't swim. He starts to talk. He got out.
Growing up, I have some questions I wrote down that I wanted to ask you.
Oh, I thought there was a purpose to your call.
First of all, we can download your State of the Industry addresses by going to iTunes. Give me instructions on how to download them, because your State of the Union address, your State of the Industry addresses
are the
most dangerous thing you can possibly do, because you're biting the hand that used to feed you.
Why do you say used to?
I don't know.
And then why did I respond to your funny line by just calling it out? You said used to. Well, here's the thing. They're not all available, though. They're only the first ones available, and the more recent ones are available on SoundCloud. So there's a whole lot of years. There's a lot to look forward to, David.
I know. It's incredible. You grew up, were you the kind of kid? You grew up in New York, right? In Long Island?
Queens.
I didn't want to know who you hung out with growing up. I'm not asking. You grew up in Queens?
You know, talk about a female impersonator. I would say that was my mom trying to make dinner.
You grew up in Queens? Really?
I grew up from normal parents? No. Whitestone, Queens.
Ask me what part of Queens I am from.
What part of Queens are you?
Flushing.
Flushing?
Well, I'm embarrassed to tell you, so I'm Flushing.
Now, wait a second. Whitestone, where I grew up, is very close to Flushing. I was 10 minutes from Shea Stadium.
Growing up, did you sit in front of the TV 12 hours a day?
Yes, I watched every single, by the way, I came up with another joke. You know, talk about female impersonators. You know, if you wanted a good female impersonator, you should have talked to my wife on our wedding night. Yes, I grew up, I'm older than you, so I grew up older than you. But I watched all these shows. I watched every sitcom I can get a hang on. I watched the show that was our favorite show in our family was the Superman TV show. And it was an awful show, but we couldn't stop watching it.
George Reeves. I used to watch that.
Oh, all day long?
Lois Lane. Noelle Neal?
Right.
I had a crush on Noelle Neal.
I had a crush on the armchair in the porch. That's how horny I was when I was a kid. I kept saying to my mother, I get that we're related. What's the problem? Why do you bring this out of me? This is like the kind of material they try and bury.
Did your family sit around and watch TV together?
Yeah, we did. We definitely did. And we watched, and, you know, like, my favorite memories are we watched All in the Family together. We watched Rhoda together.
Right.
We watched all those shows, Mary Tyler Moore.
Didn't you find yourself rooting for Valerie Harper? And by the way, Valerie Harper, and I'm not making a joke, she's still around.
She's still alive.
As is Jimmy Carter.
That's unbelievable. Now, how's she doing, though?
I don't want to make a bad taste joke. I'm just holding back. But I noticed that Jimmy Carter met with Bernie Sanders yesterday.
Right.
And he looked great. And Valerie Harper, God bless the two of them.
See, there's no reason for it. You can have a real human moment instead of your jokes.
I have like a really bad taste joke that I'm going to hold back.
Oh, okay. Let's do it.
But no, I'm not going to do it. So you would sit around. Didn't you find yourself rooting for Rhoda back then?
I loved her. I had a crush on Rhoda.
What happened when you found out she wasn't Jewish?
I'm still upset about it. You know, there's certain things I accept and there's certain things I don't accept. Like, I accept that in our one musical that we wrote, The Jews, that we still have a song that says, "Well, we love the money. Give me money, 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 money." Yeah, I accept that. I accept that that was a poor choice.
No, you're wrong. He was saying, "If I were a rich man."
Right, but why would he want to be rich? That's just reinforcing the Jewish stereotype of wanting money. Am I right about that? And Starsky or Hutch is in the original movie.
Of Fiddler on the Roof?
Yeah. I just saw it recently.
And Topol, why would they have a teeth whitening
cream?
Yeah,
that's the thing. The Topol, the smoker's tooth polish, if he came back to life, if Topol came back to life, the great Yiddish theater actor, would he be happy if there was a smoker's tooth polish named after him? What do you think?
By the way,
If Rembrandt came back, so the teeth whitening system.
Why would they name a teeth whitening system after Rembrandt? All his paintings were dark.
I know. If anything, have you checked out some of the teeth on his subjects?
Yes.
Believe me, the last thing you think about is a teeth whitening system. But the Rembrandt's heirs, even though they don't make any money because I think it's public domain, like I could name something Vincent van Gogh vodka.
I have
condoms.
I remember this was your thing, and it was you slept through art history class. But I remember you got me to invest in Vincent van Gogh monocles.
Right, I thought it was going to be big. But it was the ear. I had no idea. I thought he lost an eye. I was told he had lost an eye. What do I know? What am I supposed to research every part of? Did you know that I sold Vincent Van Gogh ear plug once? An ear plug. I used to work at the Crazy Eddies. I sold Vincent Van Gogh an ear plug.
Your mother, as I remember, was a spy for the OSS. And
my mother, if you said Ethel Rosenberg too fast near her, mm-hmm, she spit her lunch up. Was Lindbergh, what was the big crime with Lindbergh? He just wanted to, you know, come to America first. What was the big deal? Why was everyone mad at him, Lindbergh?
He wanted to save lives. He said that.
That's all he wanted to do. Not Jewish lives. Not Jewish lives.
He didn't think we could win. That was all. He was just saying that he didn't think. You want to know what I think?
I do know what I know.
Okay. You know, the Lindbergh baby. His baby was kidnapped, right?
So that maybe sent him off the rails.
By whom? Who kidnapped the Lindbergh baby?
I don't know.
Bruno Hauptmann, a German.
Oh, right? a German family? I don't know the story at all.
Oh, yeah. Bruno Hauptmann, a German.
No, you're mixing up. Are you sure you're not mixing up the Frank Sinatra Jr. getting kidnapped story? Wait a second. You're not talking about compulsion, are you? Compulsion? With Loeb and Leopold?
Leopold and no frontal lobe? Those are the Trump brothers.
But you know what? They sound... Hey, with the Trump brothers, I think I was the first person with this joke. Which one's Usay and which one's Kool-Aid?
Which one's Kool-Aid?
Kude, I think his name was. Hussein Kude.
They,
Wait a second. Is there a big story behind Lindbergh's baby? I had no idea. Who did kidnap Lindbergh's baby?
Bruno Hauptmann.
And he was a German?
He was a German. And this was, I think, during the 30s, before we got into World War II.
So why would that have made Lindbergh more pro-German?
Because of the Oedipal conflict. If the son secretly wants to kill the father and sleep with the mother, right? So Lindbergh knew that his baby wanted to kill him and sleep with Anne Morrow Lindbergh. So Lindbergh identified with Bruno Hauptmann because Bruno Hauptmann killed his baby and ended up saving Lindbergh's own life. So he identified with Hitler and the Germans during World War II.
Wait a second. How did he save Lindbergh's life?
By killing his son.
How did that save his life?
Because the son secretly wants to kill the father and sleep with the mother.
Oh, I see.
I do.
It prevented the Freudian thing from happening. But
yes.
I was hoping you'd give me some actual information in there. Do they really know? I mean, the baby was killed, right?
The baby, yeah. But seriously.
Why?
But seriously. Because.
Why didn't they get ransom money or something?
It was a.
You know, in my day when we kidnapped people, we gave a reasonable chance. It wasn't that everybody returned home safely. We would sometimes maim. Sure, we would maim our kidnapping victims. But be reasonable. Yeah, sure. Kidnap, maim, torture. But be reasonable. You know what an enhanced interrogation technique? It's Trump giving a State of the Union.
Better waterboard.
Yeah.
That
you
guy.
Better tell me, even if you don't know.
Yeah.
You better give me the wrong information.
You just give me.
Tell me anything. Tell me anything. Because I told, what's the guy's name with that horrible show everybody watched and justified torture? 24? I guess it was a good show, except for the torture.
Oh, Joel Cerno.
Yeah, the half-hour comedy hour guy.
I went to the taping of that. I walked out on it. Joel Cerno tried to do, a conservative version of The Daily Show. I called Joel up. I said, take a look at Jon Stewart's views towards unions. It's already a conservative.
Hey, maybe we could make a deal here. You don't have to remake anything. Just change the way you look at the one guy. How about when Jon Stewart said the thing about, you people aren't the problem, like the viewers. It's them. Oh, what a man, huh? You people aren't the problem, viewers and voters. It's Washington.
Oh, when he went to Washington, D.C. and told everybody to calm down.
Calm down. And he also called out all the networks and basically said, they're the problem. You're not the problem. People who paid to go to Washington and is already looking surly, like they don't know why we're here.
Mm-hmm. Where do you get your news from?
I get my news from anything, any service that has Max in the name. Newsmax. I get the news the same way I get my news. But first of all, every week I tell myself I'm going to watch the news hour.
Right.
But I never do.
McNeil is gone.
I didn't realize that.
The McNeil news hour.
You know what? I fell asleep when it's... Da, 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 da.
Well, thank God they have David Brooks at the on the show every Friday.
Yeah, so he had a format. So that he got a chance.
We're going to wrap it up. Because once we get into politics...
Oh, I'm the bad guy because after an... 45 minutes of being on the phone with you, I ran out of anything funny to say. Oh, I'm wrong. Why don't you deny me water, lock me into a room, and when I'm having heat prostration, then I see if I have a couple more one-liners in me.
Looked at the clock and I realized, oh my God.
Is the same woman from last time there?
Yes, take your hat off.
But she really wasn't mad, though, right?
I don't even remember who the woman was.
A woman comic in the studio. You said, I'm sorry I didn't get to talk to you much.
By the way, I stopped tape, so...
Oh, thank God. Thank God. Because I was about to say something funny.
I stopped tape.
Wait, can you do me a favor? When you have definitely stopped tape, please give me a heads up. Okay?
Okay. But we have stopped tape. Okay. So we're going
to
wrap up.
All right. But the thing that I need you to do.
Yeah. You want me to kidnap the Pope, right?
Have we stopped tape?
We've stopped tape. You keep calling me, let's kidnap the Pope. We'll never have to work again. And I'm saying,
It's a prank. It's a prank. He'll love it.
You keep calling me. Let's kidnap the Pope. The Vatican Bank has all this money. And I'm saying, Andy, this is dangerous stuff to kidnap a Pope.
Hey, why don't you live a little?
All right, we've stopped
tape. This is how poorly I do the character who doesn't know that the machine is still going.
We've stopped tape.
Have you stopped tape?
I've stopped tape, yes.
Okay, because here's the thing I wanted to say.
Okay.
I'm recently getting sexually attracted to neo-Nazis, and I'm a little worried about it. I can't masturbate without a swastika shoved up my pupik. Have you stopped tape?
Of course I've stopped
tape. Okay. I found something in my colon. I know what you're going to say. What was I doing in my own colon?
Andy Kindler, thank you so much.
I love you, David.
I love you too.
So much. Okay, buddy.
Okay.
Catch me on the rebound, right?
Yes. Can we plug your new thing, your new venture?
Yeah. I'm going to be on Merv Griffin tonight, and then I'm co-hosting Mike Douglas all week.
Bye. Thank you.
I love you. I love you, David.
You too.
Be good.
This is great. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.